Thank you so much. I'm gonna try to give this talk sitting down, see how that works. Thank you for inviting me to this fantastic conference, this HR Forum. It's my fourth time in Seoul. It's a beautiful city. I'm really happy to be here. So I'm gonna be talking today about my work on happiness. I just celebrated my 30th anniversary of doing research on happiness. This is my office, but let me see if this is gonna work. Maybe I should try that one, huh? All right. Okay, and a lot of the research I'll be talking about is in my book, The How of Happiness, and I have the Korean translation up there as well. And here are my fantastic collaborators. I also work with Inter Choi, our moderator as well. We have a number of studies together. So I want to start actually by taking a long step back. And by the way, I'm going to be using the word happiness, just that's the word that most people use. I'm going to take a long step back to World War II. So during the Second World War, aviation experts deployed a lot of energy and resources into studying military planes that went down. And one day somebody asked, why don't we study the planes that stay up in the air? And I think that's an apt metaphor for the work that my colleagues and I do in the field of well-being science. We study why happy people are happy, why successful people are successful, why healthy people are healthy. And I believe that most people in the world want to be happy, and actually researchers study this question. They go to all different countries and they ask people, what are their top goals in life? What are your most important goals? I'm gonna show you some data from a few countries. So first, let's look at the United States. So this is a question. The question is, how important is happiness to you on a 7-point scale? And Americans rate happiness as really important, about a 6.6 on a 7-point scale. But here's some data from some countries like Greece, Germany, of course, South Korea, China, and Argentina. And you see that people in other countries, too, rate, even though they're very different cultures. South Korea is actually almost identical to the U.S. In how important happiness is. I think the pursuit of happiness is a universal goal, or a almost a universal goal. And it's a worthwhile goal as well. So it turns out that happy people enjoy a lot of advantages, enjoy a lot of benefits. So happiness is not just about pleasure. It's not just about feeling good. When you're happy, it's not just good for you. It's good for your family. It's good for your colleagues. It's good for your society and your community. A number of years ago, a couple of my colleagues and I did what's called a meta-analysis, which is like an analysis of many analyses. We looked at 225 studies of happiness, and we found that happy people, as Jan has mentioned, are more productive at work, they're more creative, they make more money and have better jobs. Now, of course, the causal direction goes both ways, right? So making money, having a good, flexible job makes you happy, but if you're happier, if you experience more positive emotions, you also are more likely to get a better job and to make more money and to be more productive, as we've just saw in the last talk. Happier people also make better leaders and negotiators, and they have better relationships. Happier people are more likely to get married, less likely to get divorced. They have more friends. A famous study, for example, showed that women who look happy in their yearbook photos in college, they show genuine happy smiles, are more likely to get married by age 27 and have more fulfilling marriages at age 52. So your smile at age 21 predicts whether you have a good marriage 30 years later. Happier people also are healthier. They have stronger immune systems. They live longer, and they're more helpful. They're more philanthropic. They give more money to charity, and they're also more resilient, sort of are better able to bounce back from adversity. So I don't think that we need to make a choice between happiness and success, because if you choose happiness, success will follow, is what the research suggests. I just want to take a few moments to define happiness. I define happiness like a lot of psychologists do, which is that happiness has two components. It has an emotional component, and it has what's called a kind of a judgmental component. And I think of these components as being happy in your life and being happy with your life. So being happy in your life is experiencing positive emotions like tranquility, joy, enthusiasm, serenity, pride, affection. Experiencing positive emotions on a regular basis. Of course, negative emotions are also important to experience when they're not chronic and when they're appropriate to the situation. But then also having a sense that your life is good, that you're satisfied with how you're progressing towards your life goal. So those are the two components of happiness that are most important. So actually, as I was listening to Jan's talk, I decided to revise my talk about 20% and skip over a few things, because he already went over sort of some research showing that happy people are more productive at work. But I'm going to tell you about a quick study that talks about happiness and creativity. And so this is one of my favorite studies, kind of an old classic study that was actually an experiment. So sometimes researchers study the question of happiness and its outcomes by doing experiments. And so these researchers found a group of doctors. These were medical doctors, physicians, and they made them happy temporarily. Now, how do you make someone happy for a few minutes or for half an hour? There's lots of ways to do that. One way is you give them a gift. And a really good way is you give them a gift of chocolate and candy. A lot of people are happy, at least for a few minutes, when they're given a gift of candy. So these doctors were, their happy mood was induced by getting a gift of chocolate and candy. And then there was also a control group that was a neutral, kind of did not get a gift, neutral mood. And then they were given a test of creativity. Now, there are different ways of testing creativity in the laboratory, and one way is a kind of a popular test called the Remote Associates Test. Now, this is hard to do if English is not your first language. Actually, I'm not a native English speaker. I think maybe no one here is a native, on stage anyway, is a native English speaker, so it's hard for me to do too. So you get a list of three words, and here's an example: crab, sauce, and pine, and you have to find a fourth word that relates to these three words. Okay? And you get a lot of these items. So anyone know what the answer is to this one? It's apple. So crab apple, applesauce, and pineapple. You see that? So once you see it, it seems easy if you know English. But if you can do this really fast, and there's lots and lots of items like this, then the idea is that you show more creative and flexible thinking. So this study showed the doctors who were given a gift of candy did better on this test. So isn't that amazing? Just a transient, short-term positive mood can lead people to do better on this kind of task and this kind of test. So, and then I think we should appreciate the importance of short-term positive emotions. Even bursts of positive emotion throughout your workday can lead you to be more creative and more productive. Studies like this show. So to summarize so far, happy workers have been found to be physically healthier, to have stronger immune systems. That means they're less likely to get colds and stay away from work. That means they're going to be more likely to show up to work with more energy and more focus and more vigor. Happier workers are going to accomplish more. As Jan showed, they're going to offer more creative ideas. And also, they're going to be more likely to help their colleagues. Research shows that happier people make better organizational citizens, and it's very important, of course, to help each other in the workplace. So the question that I have been exploring for the last about 20 years is, can you become happier, right? So we know happier people, they feel good, right? All these good things come to them, they're more successful in lots of domains in life. But can you actually become happier? That's kind of the million-dollar question, and how can you do it? So my argument is that, yes, you can become happier. Now, in the past, there's been a lot of pessimism about whether it's even possible to be happier. Some people think that happiness is genetic, right? And some of us are just born happier than others, and you can't do anything about it. It is true that happiness is influenced by our genes, but it doesn't mean that we can't change it. Also, research shows that our life circumstances don't affect our happiness as much as we think they do. Of course, whether we're rich or poor or healthy or sick is going to affect our happiness. But once we're comfortable, once we're kind of here, you know, having more money, having more things is not going to make us as happy as sort of we think it will. But despite that, research shows that a lot of happiness is under our control. It's under our power to change by the ways that we think every day and the ways that we behave every day. So we can become happier. And this is what a lot of researchers are trying to sort of discover these days, is how can we do it? What can we do to become happier? So a lot of this is in my book, The How of Happiness. I talk about different kinds of strategies or activities that people can engage in on a regular basis that can increase their happiness. Now, look at this list. Do any of these strategies surprise you? They're not really surprising, right? Being grateful makes people happier, being optimistic, savoring the moment, practicing your religion if you have one, investing in relationships. These are all strategies that have been shown to be associated with happiness and to make people happier. And so what I do in my research is we do what we call happiness interventions or positive interventions, which are basically experiments where we instruct people to practice a particular strategy, something that has a positive outcome. So positive interventions are kind of like clinical trials. They're randomized controlled experiments where we randomly assign some people to practice, for example, count your blessings on a regular basis or do acts of kindness for others or savor positive things in your life for the next month. And then we also have certain control groups. And we also, like clinical trial, if you're a medical scientist and you're studying a new drug and you do a clinical trial, you might ask questions like, what is the optimal dosage of the drug? And should certain people not take this drug? And should this drug not be combined with other drugs? Well, we ask the same kinds of questions about something like gratitude. Is there an optimal dosage of gratitude? Can you be too grateful? Should some people not practice gratitude, right? Maybe it doesn't work for everyone. Those are the kinds of questions that I ask as well. And so we've done lots and lots of happiness interventions. These are some examples up here. Over the course of several weeks or a couple of months, we asked people to count their blessings, to act. We just did a study where we asked people to act more extroverted for a week and then to act more introverted for a week and vice versa, and to see whether happiness changed. And so I'm going to just give you a flavor of some of this empirical evidence, but just showing you a couple of studies really quickly. But there are a lot more. If you're interested, I have lots of papers I can send you. You can email me. So the focus of my research is the question, how and why do happiness-enhancing strategies work? Sort of how does the pursuit of happiness work? Sort of what are the key factors that you need to take to keep in mind for the pursuit of happiness to be successful? So here's an example. This is the very, very first intervention that my lab ever did in 1999, 20 years ago. We asked people to count their blessings for 6 weeks. So every week, we want you to write down 5 things that you're grateful for, okay? But in this study, we were interested in the optimal dosage of counting your blessings. So we had people either count their blessings once a week, every Sunday night, count your blessings, think about what you're grateful for, or we ask people to do it 3 times a week, every Tuesday, Thursday, and Sunday night. And here's what we found. And so here are changes in gratitude and changes in happiness from before to after the 6-week intervention. And you see here, you look at the red bars, those are the participants who counted their blessings once a week. They're the ones who got happier, and they became more grateful relative to the other groups. If you counted your blessings 3 times a week, nothing happened. It didn't make you more grateful. It didn't make you happier. So here's a study that showed that dosage is important, that on average, maybe if you count your blessings too often, it might become a chore. Maybe it kind of isn't meaningful after a while. Maybe it becomes a burden. Or maybe it backfires, right? If you try too hard to be grateful, you might find it difficult to think of things in your life that you're grateful for, and so you might conclude that I don't really have that much fortune in my life. By the way, there's also cultural differences. So Shoy and I did a study where we found that, actually we did a study with students at Seoul National University, and we found that students in Seoul who were asked to write gratitude letters did not get happier. But American students did get happier, and I'm happy to talk about that later, but there are cultural differences. So the same strategy doesn't always work for the same person. And actually, so here's the importance of dosage. That's a really good transition to my next point, is the importance of fit. So when you try to pursue happiness, improve your happiness, you have to think about, does this strategy fit with my personality, with my goals, with my values, with my culture, with my strengths? And for certain people, gratitude might not work. For certain cultures, it may be very beneficial. For others, it might be less so. So you have to be really careful about fit. Another thing that's important is motivation. So we did a study where we had people who are motivated and invested and interested in becoming happier. Those are the orange bars. And we ask them to either write gratitude letters or to try to be optimistic about the future. And then we compared them with people who weren't as motivated to become happier. And we found that if people who were motivated or invested in happiness, they were more successful at becoming happier. That's not surprising, right? They put more effort into it. They were more likely to take it seriously and to stick with their strategies. Just like if you wanted to become healthier and exercise more, if you're really motivated, you're going to stick with it more. You're going to put more effort into it. So motivation matters and person activity fit matters. The last factor I want to tell you about is the importance of focusing on other people. Now, I think, just my personal opinion, that a lot of, or maybe most human problems are caused because we focus too much on ourselves, right? We're dwelling, we're ruminating, we're worried, we're anxious, we're depressed. And when anything that you can do to take the focus off of yourself and put the focus onto other people or on other things, maybe it's work, maybe it's some kind of goal that you have, is going to make you happier. So in this study that I'm showing you here, we asked people to do acts of kindness every week for 4 weeks. We said, do 3 acts of kindness for other people every week for 4 weeks. That's the red line. Or we asked people, do 3 acts of kindness a week for yourself. So these are things like, I could get a massage, I could have a nice lunch, I could take a nap, you know, do something nice for yourself. We found that only people who did acts of kindness for others got happier and stayed happier. If you did acts of kindness for yourself, it didn't really do much to change your happiness, only maybe very temporarily. So this shows the importance of being oriented towards other people and how much it affects happiness. So ironically, if you want to make yourself happier, you should try to make other people happier, and that's going to make yourself happier. Okay, we also ask other questions about maybe practicing these strategies, does it have benefits beyond happiness? Does it affect other domains in life? So one question I wanted to just tell you about, one of the last things, is can doing acts of kindness also affect health? So we did a study that is really exciting that was published recently where we asked people to do acts of kindness for others or acts of kindness for yourself, and we took blood, all right, we collected blood from people from before to after we did this intervention. And we partnered with a genomics researcher at UCLA, and here's what we found. We found that only people who did acts of kindness for others over the course of a month, they showed changes in their RNA gene expression that were associated with a healthier immune profile. So you see that bar that's going down? This is acts of kindness for others, so people who helped others, as opposed to those who helped themselves or other control groups, they showed downregulation of pro-inflammatory genes. Downregulation of pro-inflammatory genes. Inflammation is bad, right? You want to have less inflammation, so more genes that are, fewer genes that are pro-inflammation. Okay, so acts of kindness for others actually have potential to change your health as well. And I want to end today with a last study that I think is kind of a nice study to end on, with a talk at a HR forum. And this is a study that I did in a Japanese engineering company where we asked the employees of this company for 6 weeks every week to write down 3 things that went well at work. So it's a very simple intervention, just an 8-minute intervention. Write down 3 things that went well at work. The control group was asked also to do something positive. They were asked to write down 3 tasks that they completed at work, 3 tasks that they completed. We found that people who wrote down 3 things that went well at work at the end of the week, so let's say every Friday, they got happier, they felt more connected with people, with their colleagues, and they showed up to work with more energy. We actually had them wear accelerometers so we could see how much they were moving. And so they were moving more in the workplace in the morning, only in the morning for some reason. Okay, so maybe we could all try this every Friday. Think about 3 things that went well at work. You will have more focus, more energy, feel more connected to your colleagues, and also be happier. So I want to say one more word. If you are a leader in the workplace, it's very important to be a leader and to model happiness. One reason it's important to be happy as a leader is that happiness is contagious, right? So if you're a leader and you're happy, your happiness is going to be contagious to your employees, to your customers, and to your colleagues. And also, when you model strengths like generosity, like savoring, like optimism, and like kindness, those strengths can spill over and propagate to your employees as well. I always like to end my talks by quoting Aristotle, who 2,000 years ago kind of summarized the main message of the research on well-being, which is that happiness depends upon ourselves. Thank you.